touring the exhibition. There are a total of 85 exhibitors in total. 20 are from Singapore and 65 are from India. It features 5 notable classifications of all the various booths: cybersecurity, healthcare and biotech, digital and fintech, innovation for social impact, and artificial intelligence. We're happy to inform you that we have 3 students from St. Stephen's College, Delhi, with 2 projects to showcase. AIM is also present, and they're exhibiting 4 projects led by 6 cool students from India. Atal Innovation Mission has set up the Atal Tinkering Labs in thousands of schools in India with the most advanced technology to let children develop a sense of curiosity, exploration, and innovation. Not forgetting robotics and 3D printing as well. We'd like to allow our guests of honor to once again tour the exhibition. If you have not done so already, may we encourage you to also visit the exhibition, perhaps during the tea break and the lunch hour as well. If you're seated, may we once again invite you, if you're not done so, to please download the Event Summit app, which is available once again in the App Store for iOS and Google Play Store for Android. The app is called Crowd Compass Attendee Hub, and upon downloading it, do type in India Singapore the next phase, do a search, and log in. The app is where you find the event schedule, bios of our speakers, panelists, a chance to network with other delegates, list of our exhibitors, and other relevant details as well. You can also send your questions and comments during the Q&A segment via Pigeonhole, a separate platform altogether. Details of that will be on the 10 card placed on your tables. For our overseas guests joining us, you'll be happy to know that Wi-Fi is complimentary. Please once again do download or connect with nice hotspots from MBS. No password is required. Please sit back, relax, as our guests of honor tour the exhibition. They will be joining us in the ballroom momentarily. Thank you for your attention. As mentioned previously, ladies and gentlemen, a total of 85 exhibitors are present here today. 20 are from Singapore, 65 are from India. 5 notable classifications of all of the various exhibitors and their booth, encompassing cybersecurity, health and biotech, digital and fintech, innovation for social impact, and artificial intelligence. Happy to inform you that we have 3 students from St. Stephen's College, Delhi, who has got 2 projects to share. AIM is also present here for this exhibition, and they're exhibiting 4 projects led by 6 cool students from India. Atal Innovation Mission has set up Atal Tinkering Labs in thousands of schools in India with the most advanced technology to let children develop a sense of curiosity, exploration, innovation to find out more about robotics and 3D printing. May we please invite you to kindly take your seats, switch all mobile devices to silent mode as we anticipate the arrival of our guests of honor who will be joining us very, very shortly. Thank you for your attention. Good morning, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning! Welcome once again to our summit, India-Singapore, the next phase. My name is Harjit Singh. Always great to see familiar faces. May we please invite you to kindly take your seats and to turn all mobile devices to silent mode, please. We anticipate the arrival of our guests of honor, His Excellency Dr. S. Jaishankar, the Minister for External Affairs, India, Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, Minister for Foreign Affairs from Singapore. They will be accompanied into the ballroom by His Excellency Mr. Javed Ashraf, the High Commissioner of India to the Republic of Singapore. That'll be happening very, very soon. If you've not taken the opportunity to download the Summit app, may we please invite you to do so. Information on the screens located in the ballroom. For overseas guests, you'll be happy to know that Wi-Fi is complimentary. Please log on to MICE hotspots from MBS. No password required as well. We also have got the social media handle, which I'd like to share with you. And maybe please encourage everyone to use it for the next 2 days. It's hashtag NSG2019 and hashtag the next phase. Also happening will be Pigeonhole, your gateway to communicate with the moderators or panel chair for each of our session. This will be very, very unique indeed. Details on how you can log on to Pigeonhole appears on the 10 card placed on your table. You can either use a QR code or perhaps go straight into the web link. Pose your burning questions. And once again, if we please invite you to also remember the passcode that you have to enter upon once again logging on to Pigeonhole, which is INSG2019, one word altogether. May we please invite you to sit back, relax. You've just seen through the live coverage that our guests of honor have toured the exhibition and will be joining us very shortly. Speaking about the exhibition once again, there are a total of 85 exhibitors. So do take the opportunity to meet as many of them as you can, perhaps during the tea break or the lunch hour. Our next announcement will be to announce the arrival of our guests of honor, but for now, may we please invite you to sit back, relax, and smile. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our guest of honor, His Excellency Dr. S. Jaishankar, Minister for External Affairs, India, Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, the Minister for Foreign Affairs, Singapore. Accompanying our distinguished guest, His Excellency Mr. Javed Ashraf, the High Commissioner of India to the Republic of Singapore. Let's give them a big welcome, please. Ladies and gentlemen, we please invite you to take your seats. Thank you. To our guests of honor, His Excellency Dr. S. Jaishankar, the Minister for External Affairs, India. A pleasure seeing you again, sir. Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, Minister for Foreign Affairs, Singapore. Good morning, Dr. Bala. His Excellency Mr. Javed Ashraf, the High Commissioner of India to Republic of Singapore. Good morning, Your Excellency. Mr. Bugana Rajendranath, Finance Minister of Andhra Pradesh. Captain Dibya Sankar Mishra, Minister of Industries, MSME, Energy and Home, Minister of State from the Government of Odisha. Professor Tommy Koh, Ambassador at Large, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Singapore. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Namaskar. And a warm welcome to Business and Innovation Summit India-Singapore, the next phase, organized by the High Commission of India in partnership with agencies of governments of India and Singapore, Chambers of Commerce, Professionals Association, and Innovation Labs. My name is Harjit Singh, privileged and honored to be your MC for the next 2 days. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, to begin today's proceedings, may we please invite the High Commissioner of India to the Republic of Singapore, His Excellency Mr. Javed Ashraf, for his welcome remarks. Join me in giving him a big one welcome, please.
Good morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure to see so many of you turn out on a Monday morning, despite a heavy traffic. Your Excellency, Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, Minister of Foreign Affairs, Republic of Singapore. Your Excellency, Dr. Subramaniam Jaishankar, Minister of External Affairs, Government of India. Sri Bugana Rajendranath, Minister of Finance, Planning and Legislative Affairs, Government of Andhra Pradesh. Captain Dibya Sankar Mishra, Minister of State for Energy, Industries, Micro and Small Medium Enterprises, and Minister of State for Home, from Government of Odisha, the large delegation of government, corporate, and technology leaders from India, the dignitaries from Singapore, my diplomatic colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to welcome you here for the India-Singapore Business and Innovation Summit. Now, the dates for any summit in Singapore is decided by the Convention Center, by the availability of space. But we are fortunate that we have been able to hold this summit almost 100 days after Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi-led government returned to power with a stronger mandate. It was an affirmation of the economic performance, and it was also a vote of confidence in the future. India-Singapore partnership has made enormous progress in the last 5 years, anchored in 4 visits of Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi to Singapore and 2 visits by Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong to India, and enormous bilateral initiatives, concrete outcomes, and steady progress across every field of bilateral endeavor. So now, as the government of India gets into its second term, we thought we should organize an event to discuss about what we will do in the next 5 years and what we call the next phase of the relationship. There are 2 interrelated conferences. We have, of course, the Business Summit, as also the Startup and Innovation Platform, Inspirener, which is the 3rd edition that was launched last year in January 2018 and has proved to be an enormous success. Today, in the course of these 2 days, we have 25 panels, 90 to 100 eminent speakers from India and Singapore, 85 to 90 startups, 65 startups from India more than 30 government officers from India, more than 30 corporate leaders from India, and out of these startups, you will see a large number of schools and college students. We have had an enormous response from the people in Singapore, nearly 4,500 registrations for this event, and it's truly a reflection of the potential and the interest in this strategic partnership. India and Singapore have built a really vibrant economic relation in our areas of strengths and development partnerships. But together we have also taken a leap into the digital future. But our relationship and our strategic partnership means more. We together have over the past three decades been bound in shared pursuit and shared endeavors for a peaceful and a prosperous region in the Indo-Pacific region. And now as Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi outlines his vision of taking India to a $5 trillion economy in 2024, modernizing the economy and expanding access, empowerment, and inclusion for every citizen of India, there is no better opportunity for expanding our partnership than now. Indeed, at a time and an age of disruptions and transitions, Singapore and the world will find no better land of opportunity and stability than India. India will find no better gateway to the world than Singapore. And together, there is no better time to deepen our strategic partnership than now. And to discuss these extraordinary range of issues, there are no better people than the three eminent panelists that we have here today for the morning session. Your Excellency, Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, he is a doctor by training, diplomat by instinct, generous by nature. He keeps a very sharp lens on the present and has a very clear long-term vision. And few in the world have spoken about technology, globalization, and geopolitics as he has. And over the last several years, he's been a great source of strength for India-Singapore strategic partnership. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to have him here today with us. Today, I have a very special guest, one that you're all familiar with. He's been a High Commissioner of India and Singapore. He has been an ambassador of India to China and the United States. And it is rare, in fact, perhaps the only time in history of independent India that an ambassador has had the privilege of welcoming in the same tenure a foreign secretary back as the External Affairs Minister of India. There are, in the course of these last 20 years since the turn of the century, India has transformed not only within, but also in its engagement with the world. And few people in India have had such a profound impact on the course of India's external engagement and global profile as Dr. Subramaniam Jaishankar. It's a great pleasure to have him here with us today. And there can be no one better to moderate a conversation between them than the legendary Professor Tommy Koh, a voice of conscience, a great champion of rules-based order, and the architect of the United Nations Convention on the Law of Seas, which remains the underpinning of maritime security and the course of the world in this century. It's a great pleasure to welcome you here, Professor Tommy Koh. Ladies and gentlemen, before I hand over the mic, I know we are running a little behind schedule, but I wanted to just say a word of thanks that an event of this scale and this depth and diversity would not have been possible without the generous support of all our sponsors, by Government of India, by the four state governments that we are present here today, by Ministry of Foreign Affairs and the Ministry of Trade and Industry of Singapore, by Enterprise Singapore, by FICCI and CII, by Singapore Business Federation, by Data Security Council of India, and by so many other professionals in Singapore who act as the great bridge between India and Singapore. So ladies and gentlemen, over the next 2 days, together we will set the stage for a partnership for the ages. Please enjoy the 2 days of an extraordinary discussion between 90 great minds. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we all have downloaded the app, which once again contains a very intuitive, informative, shows you the schedule, the list of exhibitors, our speakers, and also our panelist stellar as well. At this juncture, before we commence with the in-conversation segment, may we explain a bit more about the Q&A segment that we'd like to engage you with. So for any questions that you'd like to pose, may we please encourage you to use Pigeonhole. Details on how you can log in appears on the 10 card that's placed on your table. For overseas delegates, you'd be happy to know that Wi-Fi is complimentary. Please once again log on to MICE hotspot. No password is required. Time for us to commence with In Conversation. It gives me great pleasure to invite His Excellency, Dr. Subramaniam Jaishankar, Minister for External Affairs, India, Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, Minister for Foreign Affairs, Singapore, and this discussion will be moderated by Professor Tommy Koh, Ambassador at Large from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Singapore. Let's give them a big one welcome, please.
I would like to begin by wishing all my Indian friends namaste. We are starting 25 minutes late, and Singaporeans are neurotic about punctuality, so I'm going to suggest that we shorten this session from 45 minutes to 30 minutes, and we will end at 10:40 a.m. Before I ask the two ministers to speak, I want to thank the High Commissioner Javed for your very generous introduction. When he described me as legendary, what he meant was that I'm very old and I'm on the brink of extinction. But thank you nevertheless. Now, the agreement between us is that Jai will go first, followed by Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, and then I will ask the first two questions, and then we open it to the floor. So Jai, you go first.
Okay. About 5 minutes?
You will speak from here?
Oh. Perhaps it's easier to speak from there. Oh,
okay. Go ahead.
That's okay?
Go ahead.
Maybe about 5 minutes?
You will speak from there also?
Myself
following.
A very good morning to all of you. Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan, Professor Tommy Koh, my ministerial colleagues from Andhra Pradesh and from Orissa, High Commissioner Javed Ashraf, ladies and gentlemen. Let me say, and I mean this really from the bottom of my heart, that it's a great pleasure to be back in Singapore. I see really before me so many friends and acquaintances that it just makes you feel very good coming back here. Today we are really in a sense entering a new phase of our strategic partnership, and I can't think of a better way of doing that than through an event like this. Now, this is an unbiased statement. The High Commission has always set very high standards, but I think Javed has really taken it to a new level, so I would really like to congratulate him, and I know I speak for all of you in this. So now let me steal a famous Tommy Cole line and say, my wife allowed me to make 3 points. So my first big points today, when we came together in the contemporary phase of our relationship, it was a time when the world was changing and India was changing. And the two changes had something to do with each other. India, if you recollect, at that time had a severe balance of payments crisis and was embarking on a radical economic reform. And the world was changing. The Cold War was coming to an end. It was very clear that a lot of the assumptions on which the world was working had to be revised. And in that situation, in that juxtaposition, India turned to Singapore. And Singapore responded. We had what was known as the Lucas policy. And Singapore, then under the prime ministership of Goh Chok Tong, became a key partner in India's growth and development. It also became our bridge to this region. In 1992, we launched the India-ASEAN partnership, and by 2005, we had become members of the East Asia Summit. During this period, Singapore was a leading source of direct investments into India. Its financial market was a major source of capital through other routes such as external commercial borrowings and foreign portfolio investment. It was a partner in many ways of Indian development and its priorities. And in turn, it was a favored, comfortable destination for Indian companies going abroad. 20% of our overseas investments came to Singapore. Eventually, 9,000 Indian companies registered here. 18 cities of India were connected to Singapore through 500 weekly flights. And quite appropriately, Singapore was the first country with whom we signed a comprehensive economic partnership agreement. It was my privilege to serve here as High Commissioner. Just as these developments took off, I was here at a time when the CECA was being implemented. And when I look back over these last 10 years, really there is a lot that we need to congratulate ourselves about. On the political side, on the strategic side, our participation in the East Asia Summit has grown to cooperation in other areas. We have a very robust defense relationship. Singapore, in fact, we've just completed 25 years of uninterrupted naval exercises, which I think is the longest that India has with any country in the world. We have now extended that as a trilateral with Thailand as well. So in both in political, strategic, as well as in the economic, commercial areas, it's very clear that Singapore has become a fulcrum for India's policies east of India. What started off as a bilateral relationship is something which has grown very much bigger. And part of that is also because on key issues, particularly rules-based order, which Professor Koh symbolizes, we actually think very similarly. The second point, I think we are again at another cusp of history, again where the world is changing, where India is changing. And this new juxtaposition offers new opportunities for the relationship. In geopolitics, it's not just the rise of China and the sharper competition between the United States and China, but the simultaneous rise of several countries, the promise of an Asian century whose realization still has challenges to overcome. There is obviously today no hegemonic power to underwrite an international order, but nor is there a global compact among nations. So we have a situation, the international situation today is under stress, a stress of a very different kind than 1992. We do see multilateralism in retreat. There are question marks about the effectiveness of institutions that we had set up in the last 50 years. And look at the picture in India. The picture in India is actually very different. The picture in India is of a new confidence society, whose political landscape is actually with seeing changes we haven't seen for 30 years. A government with a strong majority and an enormous mandate. There are massive processes internally to transform the economy and build a more cohesive national framework. We are engaging the world today with more self-assurance and clarity. So, given the fact that we are once again at a moment of change in India, a moment of change in the world, what does it mean for the India-Singapore relationship? I would say that for us, the economics of the relationship will always be important. It is the foundation of our strategic partnership. And India's journey towards a 5 trillion economy, as well as the emerging global economic situation, offer new possibilities, but also challenges in some ways to building further on that economic foundation. Beyond the traditional areas of cooperation, we have entered the digital age with its own opportunities. We have entered it individually, we have entered it collaboratively and internationally. And areas like fintech today offer again a promise that needs to be explored. India is a country of SMEs in many ways. So when we look at trade, when we look at negotiations such as the RCEP, which is underway. Again, it's important both economically and strategically. A trade agreement is a balance of negotiated interests. Certainly, where the RCEP is concerned, the economic merits of its terms should be self-evident for it to succeed. Connectivity is another important aspect of our agenda. And beyond connectivity, I think today there is the larger strategic concept or approach or vision, depending on which country you are, of the Indo-Pacific. So how do we engage each other, but in a different landscape, a much more integrated landscape between the Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean? I think that too is food for thought. In many ways, Singapore actually is the progenitor of the Indo-Pacific, because by getting India into the East Asian Summit, it actually in many ways facilitated the bridge between the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean. For India, Prime Minister Modi has articulated a very clear vision here in Singapore in 2018. We look at an open, inclusive and balanced region, connected by secure seas, integrated by trade and investment, underpinned by the rule of law, and anchored in ASEAN unity and centrality, with East Asia Summit as its principal forum. So, as I look at the future of this relationship, in many ways, we take satisfaction in the journey that we have done so far together. We are today poised at a very important juncture in world politics. It's not obviously an easy time, but it's also not a disheartening time. I think a lot would depend on the imagination and the dexterity with which we together address many of the challenges before us. And certainly I can assure all our Singaporean friends that I come here today as a representative of a new government in India, a different government, a government with a strong commitment to modernize India, to change it in many ways far more deeply than we have done in the past. And on that optimistic note, perhaps I could hand the floor back to Professor Kerr.
Thank you, John. I thank Foreign Minister Dr. Jaishankar for a very optimistic presentation. I now ask Dr. Velan Balakrishnan to speak.
Thank you.
I couldn't hear very well.
Dr. Jaishankar, Professor Tomiko, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be here. Let me start by posing this question to all of you. If you go back 2,000 years, where were the major economies of the world? And the answer is, if you go back 2,000 years, there was already Rome. Rome was a significant and major empire in its own right. And then, if I ask you the next question, was there trade between Rome and India? And the answer is yes. And then, if you fast forward another 1,000 years, and I pose this next question to you, what was the share of global GDP that India and China constitute 1,000 years ago? And the answer is that these two ancient civilizations constituted about half the global GDP. Now, move forward another 5 centuries. If you go to the late 15th century, the age of discovery was occurring in Europe. The Renaissance, the discovery or rediscovery of science, and in particular, the incipient beginnings of the technological revolution, meant that per capita GDP in Europe was at least double that in India and in China. And the Europeans back then already knew about the wealth of India. And that's why in 1492, in fact, when Christopher Columbus landed in America, what he was really in search of was India and the wealth of India. And in 1497 to 1499, Vasco da Gama, the Portuguese explorer, circumnavigated the Horn of Africa, reached India. I think he reached Calicut, which is a port city in Kerala. And then began the European colonization of India. One question which I would also leave with you then is, why and how did this happen? And my hypothesis is that it was because the Industrial Revolution began in Europe and they amassed enormous technological, economic, and ultimately military power. And that was the fuel for colonization. And then we've had the last few centuries as we know it. The reason why I've taken this extended jaunt through history is because I wanted to leave a few points on the table. One, India has always been an ancient and wealthy component of global GDP. Second, trade has always been a part of that. Third, do not underestimate the importance of industrial revolutions and the disruption that has on the distribution of power and its long-term impact on us. Fast forward to today. I believe we are on the cusp of another industrial revolution. Whether you call it Industry 4.0 or the digital revolution, whatever you call it, when you are on the cusp of another revolution, you must anticipate disruption on the similar scale that has occurred 500, 1,000, or even 2,000 years ago. Therefore, that sets the context of how we view the world, how we assess the trends that are unfolding, and how to maximize the opportunities. I don't have time to explore all those implications, but I wanted to leave these thoughts on the table for you to consider. If I was now to zoom down, specifically to the dynamics between India and Singapore, let me share a few thoughts. The history of Singapore as a trading port can never be said the Asian Eurasian landmass at the Straits of Malacca, at the fulcrum between the northeast monsoon and the southwest monsoon, was always part of trade between India and China. And then with the advent of the Industrial Revolution and the arrival of the Europeans, we became part of ultimately not just an Indo-Pacific port, but indeed across to the Pacific and to the Atlantic. Now, what this means is that Singapore has always sought to integrate India into the regional architecture. That's why, as Dr. Jaishankar mentioned, Singapore was a key advocate for the inclusion of India into the East Asian Summit. We have always believed that India belongs to this part of the world. We have always viewed India to be an essential and invaluable partner, the force and the navy. And it is, and as maritime nations, our navies have been exercising together annually for the past 26 years. Together with Thailand, we will be holding a trilateral naval exercise in the Andaman Sea in late September. So this has been another lesser known fact, the strength of our defense relations. Let me move quickly to the economic front. And why are we such strong believers in the economic potential of India and its importance to Singapore's own prospects? Let me give you a few grounds for optimism. First, the economic growth of India that we are witnessing is ground up. Yes, of course, the government has a master plan. Yes, of course, the Indian government, especially since 1991, opened up the economy. But the truth is, this is ground up. Indian companies have arisen. Some people say despite the license raj, they have survived, they have thrived under sometimes difficult and challenging circumstances. If you look at our trade figures, the bilateral trade between India and Singapore currently stands at US$18.7 billion. Another interesting factoid, if I was to ask you, who is India's largest foreign investor at this point in time? The answer that may be surprising to some of you is that Singapore is India's largest foreign investor at $16.2 billion. And I want to add, because I know there are regulators in this room, that almost all that money is from Singaporean and Singapore-based companies. This is not round-tripping. I'll give you another example of what I think is a successful joint project. The Tata Singapore Airlines joint venture, Vistara, has launched its first international flights in August from New Delhi and Mumbai, respectively, to Singapore. And we hope to see more of such connectivity, especially in the air. We welcomed 1.44 million Indian visitors in 2018. A big number, but frankly, if you look in terms of the size of the Indian population, this is only a drop in the ocean, but it gives you an idea of the potential. The second reason for optimism is that a lot of the growth which we are witnessing in India is really about the digital space. Both India and Singapore have embraced the digital economy in a big way. And we believe that our collaboration in this space will be a pathfinder for others in the region. For instance, RuPay can already be used in Singapore. In fact, Prime Minister Modi launched it during his last visit here. And both of us, Singapore and India, are working to expand this network so that we can benefit more visitors, tourists, and businessmen in Singapore and in India and beyond. The dream is to make cross-border digital payments real-time, seamless, and at the lowest possible transaction costs. This will benefit hundreds of thousands, millions of workers, expatriate workers, business people, and tourists as trade flows between our regions expand exponentially. Now, this is not just about opportunities for businessmen. Think about the Indian foreign worker anywhere in the globe, just trying to send money back to his mother. I think that worker deserves to have the most seamless, most pain-free, and the lowest transaction cost system in order to send his money, hard-earned money, back to the mother. Similarly, think about the small business owner, the entrepreneur, the hawker, the artisan, for him or her to be able to access a global market and to be paid in the most cost-effective way possible. This is really about democratizing economic opportunities across the spectrum for everyone. So we're very glad that the Monetary Authority of Singapore and the Indian Department of Economic Affairs has a joint working group on fintech. And you know that Singapore now hosts one of the largest fintech festivals in the world. And within that, you will know that the Indian participation, the Indian booth, is the largest within that. All this is reason for optimism. Third reason for optimism is about young people. Would you believe that 30% of the India's population today is below the age of 14? If that's not enough, 62% of India's population is today aged 15 to 59. This means there is an incredible demographic dividend available to India over the next 5 decades. And this is a unique pole advantage that India has compared to any other major economy in the decades to come. Now, a demographic dividend needs to be harvested. Whether or not this will be harvested will depend upon successful reform within India to educate young people, to democratize opportunities, to reform and open up the economy, and to connect the Indian economy to the rest of the world. But assuming all this is achieved, can you imagine the tsunami of opportunities that will come the way of the Indian youth and their links to the rest of the world? And that's why it's also important that you will notice in the booths today, we have a more than proportionate representation from young people. Another of Prime Minister Modi's brainchild was to bring together our youth from tertiary institutions from both India and Singapore, and he suggested having a 36-hour hackathon. And Singapore and Indian students have formed combined teams. They've already started discussions to find solutions to quality education, good health and well-being, affordable and clean energy. Again, imagine the power of the innovation, the passion and the energy of young people solving these fundamental challenges of the future. So I've given you the reasons for optimism. The next question is, well, what are we going to do about it? Prime Minister Modi announced the goal of India becoming a US $5 trillion economy by 2024, 5 years from now. In effect, he's asking for a doubling of India's GDP. It is a significant challenge. India is also targeting to invest 1 trillion rupees. I think that's about 13.9 billion US dollars over the next 5 years in urban infrastructure and solutions. This is critical because we all know that India is projected to rapidly urbanize over the next few years. Cities are projected to double from 42 to 68 cities. The urban population will increase from 200 million to 340 million, all the way to 540 million, and ultimately, in the next decade or so, I think about 40% of India's population will live in cities. This is a huge opportunity for businesses in this sector. And we believe Singapore, a tiny city-state, which is welcoming and familiar to Indian businesses, tourists, and visitors, we believe we are a natural partner as India urbanizes, and our expertise in urban development planning and infrastructure finance will be salient to India. Prime Minister Modi has also listed water conservation as a priority during his recent Independence Day address on the 15th of August. No one understands the sanctity and how to make off water and how to make every drop count as much as Singapore. And here again, in our own small way, but significant way, we believe our experience in water will be relevant to India. Nexus between India and China, and also having those links to America and Europe. If we succeed in constructing a multilateral rules-based system with economic integration, free trade, investments in infrastructure and urbanization, investments in the software of the brains of our young people, if we can achieve all this, then a golden age awaits us, a golden age which has been overdue for both India and China and Southeast Asia. So on that note of optimism, let me thank you for your attention. Look forward to your questions and discussion. Thank you all very much.
I thank Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan for his statement. I'm sorry to report to you that we're out of time. It's already 10:40 a.m., but you will agree that no meeting is complete if we don't subject the speaker to some challenging questions. So I'm going to ask on your behalf the two hottest questions on your minds. First, one of the bilateral projects between India and Singapore which has caught the imagination of many Singaporeans is a project to build a new capital city in Andhra Pradesh called Amaravati. So my question to the two ministers is Amaravati sick, very sick, or dead? Jai, you go first.
Actually, you have the wrong minister. The minister is sitting somewhere out there.
I know that we have the finance minister.
That's the minister you need to.
But what's the union government's view?
Actually, I think it's very much their call. So I think this question is better handled by.
So Vivian, do you have a take on this?
I was going to ask the finance minister who's sitting right in front of me. To answer the question, but maybe that's not fair to put him on the spot. But with your indulgence, let me give you
your take.
A perspective from Singapore. In 2014, the then government of Andhra Pradesh sought Singapore's assistance to master plan a new capital, Amaravati. Why was there a need for new capital? Well, again, the previous government had bifurcated Andhra Pradesh into two states. A consortium was formed, Ascendas, Singbridge, and Sembcorp Corporation was awarded through a competitive Swiss challenge the opportunity to form a joint venture with the then Andhra Pradesh government to master develop the capital using green and sustainable urban solutions. And in which, quite frankly, Singapore companies have significant expertise. And this collaboration was complemented by a government-to-government memorandum of understanding between the government of Singapore and the government of Andhra Pradesh, focusing especially on training and capacity development. And this was endorsed by the union government. There is a new state government in Andhra Pradesh that took power on the 30th of May. And I want to state here for the record for the incoming, for the new finance minister, that all governments are perfectly entitled to review their plans. And if you want to review the plans for the capital city, you're perfectly entitled to do so. So the Singapore consortium companies have informed me that they will wait. They will wait for decisions to be made by the current government. And they will evaluate the impact of these new review and regulations on their investment opportunities. I should also state for the Singaporeans here that no government grants or subsidies from Singapore were deployed for this project. This is a private sector commercial decision. And I would also add that when private companies from Singapore or anywhere else for that matter, make investment decisions, all companies have to take into account political and regulatory risk. This is part and parcel of doing business. And I would also add, it is also the prerogative of the local government to adjust their plans and priorities from time to time. And it is the prerogative of investors to decide whether to stay or to leave. What transcends such changes is the sanctity of contracts. And when certain terms and conditions are entered into to safeguard the interests of the clients as well as the solution provider, such contracts are entered in accordance with the existing laws of the land and must be honored as such. And I would also submit that governments need to consider the signal that they send to investors. In the case of Singapore, we have remained a highly competitive economy because we have provided, for the long term, a stable and predictable environment for investors, both local and foreign. And this actually lowers the cost of doing business. This encourages more investments. So I would ask everyone, let's give time to the new government in Andhra Pradesh to sort out their priorities, sort out their plans, and then allow the private sector to make their own decisions rationally on commercial grounds. I think we should leave it there and not make it more complicated for the new government in Andhra Pradesh.
My next question is for Dr. Jaishankar. In a contemporary world, free trade is being challenged by protectionism, and multilateralism is being undermined by preference for bilateralism and unilateralism. Given this context, it's very important for us to successfully conclude the negotiations for a regional comprehensive economic partnership agreement, which involves 16 countries and will represent one-third of world GDP. The 16 trade ministers have just completed their latest round of negotiations in Bangkok over the weekend. Many people think the fate of RCEP is in the hands of India. So I think, Jai, you are the right person to answer my question.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Is India ready to join the other 15 partners to cross the finishing line this year?
I completely agree today that it's important to protect multilateralism, strengthen the WTO, which is under pressure. And obviously, a lot of trade is bilateral between countries. Sure. So the issue is, what's there between multilateralism and bilateralism? And I think both India and Singapore are clear, they don't like unilateralism. Okay. So what's in that space is largely free trade agreements of different kinds. And the fact is, if you look at what's happening in the world is moving towards more and more of its trade getting covered by FTAs. So conceptually, the merits of an FTA are indisputable. So let's come to RCEP per se. Now, India has FTA with all the other countries of RCEP, either bilaterally, like with Singapore or Japan or Korea, or regionally, as with ASEAN. So the new countries being covered are China, Australia, and New Zealand. Now, the big concerns of India are, of course, one, its relationship with China, because we run an enormous trade deficit with China. Mm-hmm. Not just run a trade deficit, but run a trade deficit which we believe is a result of unfair restricted market access. Okay, so it's not really a comparative advantages playing out, it's actually Chinese policies which are, Chinese protectionist policies which have created that outcome. And there is obviously concern in India about exports out of China into the Indian market. So there's a big China concern out there. The second set of concerns relate to services, because by and large, any arrangement on goods, they are enforceable. There are WTO regulations about that, but the enforceability of trade in services is much weaker. So we have, for example, mutual recognition agreements in different professions, which often take years to sort of make themselves felt. And that's been the case even with Singapore. The third, I think, is when we look at the past FTAs, we've actually seen often there's a kind of a cultural element to an FTA, which is there are countries who are able to shape their imports and export based on networking, which determine choices rather than market economics determining those choices. So at a time, for example, when Indian steel is competitive globally, it's not necessary that Indian steel exports go up because there are non-market factors at play in some countries. So I think those are some of the concerns that India has had as it's gone into the RCEP negotiation. I would make one important, now I don't know exactly what happened. I was in touch with my trade minister, but I don't know finally what was discussed yesterday. The big point I would make is this. Look, RCEP at the end of the day is an economic negotiation. It has a strategic implication. But the merits of the RCEP outcome have to be economic. You know, you can't sell a trade agreement for its foreign policy benefit.
I agree.
You know, it has to be sold for its trade benefit. I think if that was more self-evident to Indians, I think you'd get clearly a much stronger resonance out of India.
I think.
Okay, can I respond?
Yeah. Thank you, Vivian.
Let me give you a Singapore perspective on this. And I think Jai Shankar will agree that Singapore has been the most reliable and forward-leaning in advocating for India's integration and inclusion with our part of the world. I state that as a fact, and I think it's one which all Indians would recognize. The second fact I've already alluded to earlier, that in fact Singapore is now the largest foreign investor in India. A third fact is that Singapore is also, surprisingly, right now the largest foreign investor in China. The fourth fact is that China is our largest trading partner. Fifth, the trading account with India is also expanding in a major way. We also have a significant economic relationship with the United States of America. In fact, the largest foreign investor in Singapore is the US, is the United States. Now, if you add up all these facts, where does this lead us to? If I was to ask you, in the next decade or two to come, isn't it obvious that China and India are going to have a significant trading relationship? And this is something that India and China will have to sort out. And I'm sure in due course of time, bilateral arrangements will be made. But even as this rapprochement or modus vivendi between India and China occurs, what we are trying to offer with RCEP is a multilateral model, a pan-regional model, center of gravity in the Indo-Pacific. And if we can sort out fair rules which will promote trade and economic integration between India, China, and Southeast Asia, there's enormous opportunity. Now, I say all this without in any way trying to trivialize or to gloss over the difficulties in negotiations, you know, trade in goods, trade in services, intellectual property, and so on and so forth. But I'm making the argument that it is worth making that effort because this will be a game changer. The 10 countries of Southeast Asia, India, China, Japan, Korea, Australia, New Zealand, this would be the mother of all trade agreements. And precisely at a time when the world is facing a pushback against globalization, against free trade, against economic integration, we believe it is all the more important for those of us who believe that this is a recipe for peace and prosperity to make the effort. And I remain optimistic that because of the nature of the Indian economy and the transformation which Prime Minister Modi is implementing it, in fact, India can deal with this from a position of confidence. Let's make the effort, because at the end of the day, you know as well as I do that all free trade negotiations actually begin at home. Every negotiator needs to understand in fine detail both the strengths and weaknesses of its own domestic sector in order to forge a deal which makes sense. And the final political point I would make is this. In India, in China, in Southeast Asia, the key political question is, can we arrive at a formula that would expand a rising middle class and give the children of the middle class a sense of optimism for the future? So whilst we all have defensive interests, let's also try to look beyond that. And if we can truly create a world with arrangements that expands the middle class, I think we would have achieved our ultimate goals. Thank you.
Thank you. I think I'll bring this to a close. It's 11 o'clock already. So I don't want to embarrass the finance minister, Andhra Pradesh, on Amaravati. I hope that Amaravati is only slightly ill and will recover and have good health. On RCEP, I think Jai made a very important point that we cannot expect India to support a trade agreement on political grounds, that the agreement must make economic sense to India. I agree with that. And I think you articulated some real concerns. Huh? I mean, on everybody's behalf, I hope this concern can be worked out and we can still conclude the RCEP negotiation before the end of this year. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Your Excellencies, and thank you, Professor Tommy Koh. I'd like to invite Your Excellencies and Professor Tommy Koh to pose for a photo opportunity once again. a great conversation.